All right, let's get started. I'm Ram, I'm a PhD student at the University of Wisconsin. Today I'll be presenting our protocol-aware recovery for consensus-based storage. This was actually a paper at LastFest, but in this talk, I'm not going to talk about this particular paper, but also some of the prior work that led to this paper. So let's start with how distributed storage systems fail. So in a distributed storage system, a data item is typically stored on several servers. And so even if some of the nodes crash or if they remain unreachable due to network failures, the system as a whole is unaffected because the redundancy in the system masks these failures, and so the data is available and correct. However, in addition to system crashes and network failures, the data stored on the individual nodes sometimes could be faulty. That is, the data could be corrupted or it could remain inaccessible because of an underlying disk corruption or a latent sector error. We call such failures storage faults. Storage faults is a real problem and is prevalent in many deployments as shown by many studies and also several pieces of anecdotal evidences. So this naturally raises a question of how can we deal with, how do current distributed storage systems react to and handle storage faults? So in the first part of the talk, we're just going to do this. We are going to inject storage faults into distributed storage systems and then understand how they are reacting to storage faults. And as you might have expected, the results are not so good. And then the second part, so we're going to build solutions to this problem. Specifically, we're going to build a new recovery protocol that enables distributed systems to correctly recover from storage faults. So in the first part of the talk, to understand how distributed storage systems react to storage faults, we study the behavior of 8 popular distributed systems. And the main result from our study is that redundancy does not imply fault tolerance. That is, a single storage fault injected in a single node in the distributed system can cause catastrophic outcomes such as silent corruption, unavailability, data loss, and so on. On the left side of the slide, I have shown all the 8 systems that we studied. These include like popular ones such as Cassandra, RethinkDB, Kafka, and so on. All of these systems have these problems. So when you just inject a single fault in a single node, your data could be lost even though you have redundant copies in the system. So I showed you that redundancy does not imply fault tolerance, but you might be wondering if these things are actually some implementation bugs in these systems. However, our study informs the other way. We find that most of these problems are because of some fundamental root causes, and there are 4 different fundamental root causes. First, we find that faults are often undetected locally by the node where we inject the fault. This leads to harmful global effects. Second, we find that even if a system detects faults, crashing is the most common reaction instead of using the redundancy inherent in the system to recover from the fault. And third, we note that crash and corruption handling are entangled. That is, systems do not differentiate between a corruption that is that occurs because of a system crash and from a corruption that occurs because of a faulty storage device. And we finally note that there is some sort of unsafe interaction that's possible between the local behavior of the node where we inject a fault and also the and between the global distributed protocols that the system as a overall runs. So given all these problems, in the second part of the talk, we are going to build new solutions to these problems. We are specifically trying to answer how do we make distributed storage systems correctly recover from storage faults. So we are going to solve this in an important class of systems that we call replicated state machines. These are actually the systems that are built on top of protocols such as Paxos and Raft. And examples of these protocols, systems include ZooKeeper and etcd. And these kind of systems hold probably the most critical data in your deployment. The solution to this problem is what we call corruption-tolerant replication, or control in short. In the presence of storage faults, control ensures that your data will not be lost. And it also ensures high availability. And it does so with low performance overheads. We have applied control to 2 different systems based on 2 different consensus protocols, LogCabin, which is based out of Raft, which came out of Stanford, and ZooKeeper, which is based on this ZooKeeper atomic broadcast protocol. We have experimentally showed that control actually provides safety and high availability, and it does so with little overheads. So that was the introduction to the talk, and here is the rest outline for the rest of my talk. As I told you, there are 2 parts. In the first part, we are going to measure and understand how distributed storage systems react to storage faults. And in the second part, we are going to build solutions to address these problems. And finally, I'll summarize and conclude. So before we go into the first part, I'll just briefly set the context of what our fault model is. So let's say we have a simple distributed system with 3 servers. And let's say we have a client which is trying to perform a workload such as reading a data item. It sends a request to do this. In order to satisfy the request, the servers interact with each other, and also they interact with their local file systems. So our fault model is very simple in that we are just going to inject a single fault into a single file system block on a single node at a time. It's as simple as that. So let's say, for example, for this particular run of the workload, we are just going to inject one block corruption on server one. And for the next run of the same workload, we are just going to return a read error for one particular block on server one, and so on. Our fault model captures behaviors of common file systems such as ext4 and butterfs. For example, if you consider that the replicas are running on the ext4 file system, and if there is an underlying disk corruption, then ext4 would just return the corrupted data access to applications because it does not use user-level checksums for user data. Consider, on the other hand, if the replicas run a file system such as butterfs, which uses checksums for user data, such a file system would detect this corrupted data because of the checksums, and it would transform that corrupted data into an IO error for applications. That is why we introduce both corruptions and errors in the fault model. So to inject the faults that I showed in the previous slides, we have developed errorfs. It's a fuse user-level file system that can inject all the faults that I showed you. So, and we have also created a set of system-specific workload suites. For example, let's say the workload is a read workload. The client is just trying to perform a read of some data item in the distributed system. Now, let's say for this particular run, we would like to inject a read corruption for a particular block on server one. So when we perform the workload, the server is going to perform a read on the file system, which comes to errorfs. Errorfs actually reads the contents off the disk, but just before returning it to the application, it just slightly tweaks the bits of the corrupted, the block that needs to be corrupted, in effect corrupting the block. And that's how we inject faults. Once we inject a fault, we need to observe two things. One, we need to first observe the local behavior of the node where we inject the fault. For example, in this case, we have injected the fault at server one. And so the server one could crash, or it could just retry the operation. It could ignore the faulty data and then return the response. Or it could not even just detect the problem in the first place. These are just the local behaviors of the node where we have injected the fault. There is also the global effect at the distributed system level of what happens because of the injected fault. Ideally, notice that we are just injecting a single problem into a single block. And so we should not ideally see any global effects. There should not be any badness because of a single fault, because that's why we build distributed systems, we have replicas. However, some of the possible things that might go bad is your data could be corrupted, or your data could be lost, or the system could be unavailable. So as I showed you, we are going to repeat this process for all the blocks across all the servers for different workloads. For example, in run one, we are going to inject a particular fault and observe the local behavior and the global behavior. And in the second run, we are going to inject a different fault and do the same thing and so on. So using this fault injection methodology, we have studied 8 systems ranging from metadata stores, popular ones such as ZooKeeper, and even message queues, Kafka, and column stores such as Cassandra and so on. So to illustrate our study, I'll just provide you an example. Redis is a popular data structure store with a leader and a couple of followers. The data is stored in the form of append-only files. And so when a client sends an update, the leader first stores that update in the append-only file and also propagate these updates to the followers. Periodically, the append-only files are snapshotted to a Redis database file. And when the followers, when they start up, they request a sync from the leader, which then ships the entire Redis database file to the follower. And the followers just replace their append-only files with the shipped Redis database file. This is just a setup to just describe how we conduct our experiments. So I'm just going to show you the results for fault injection results for the Redis read workload. So we're going to present our results in small sort of grids like these. We injected corruptions and read errors for this particular workload. We inject them on the leader and the follower. And we are going to inject them on all these different on-disk structures that I showed you in the previous slide. And as I told you, once we inject a fault, we need to observe two things. First, we need to observe the local behavior. For example, when we inject inject a corruption in the metadata portion of the append-only file on the leader, we note that the leader crashes, which is shown by this cross mark here. This is just the local behavior of the node. Now we need to observe the global effect of the fault. For the same fault, given that Redis does not do automatic leader election, when the current leader crashes, the system becomes unavailable. When we arrive at such a state, we try to reason why we actually arrived at this state. For the specific case, we note that first there are no checksums in Redis to detect the corruption. So when we introduced a corruption into the metadata of the append-only file, the leader failed to deserialize that file, and so it crashed. Once the leader crashes, and given that there is no automatic failover, the system becomes unavailable. We next inject a similar fault in the follower. We also observe that the follower fails. However, it does not lead to a unavailability, but it leads to reduced redundancy. We see very similar behaviors for read errors. And when we corrupt the data portion of the append-only file, we first notice that Redis does not detect this because it does not use checksums. And so it silently returns the corrupted data to the users. This is the global effect. So the reason behind this behavior is that, as I told you, there is no checksums in Redis to detect corruption. The leader does not detect this, and so it returns the corrupted data to the user's assets. And further, it takes this corrupted data and propagates it to the followers. So basically, it installs the bad copy on every other node. So when we inject the same fault in the follower, although it does not lead to a harmful behavior, it leads to a correct behavior because the leader just fetches the latest Redis database from the followers just fetch the latest Redis database file from the leader. And we similarly conduct this experiment for all other data structures, and then we populate these grids. We do this for many systems, and we do this for all workloads. So we conduct a very similar analysis for all the different systems that I showed you. And I'm not going to present these results here, but I'll show you just a gist of all these results. So as I told you, we performed different workloads on different systems. We injected corruptions and read errors on different data structures, either in the follower or the leader. And then note that we just injected a single fault in a single machine at a time. So we should not be ideally seeing any bad effects here. However, this is a summary of our results. As you can see, just a single fault can cause read corruption. Your system could lose the data, or the system could become unavailable, or queries could fail, or the system could run with reduced redundancy. So what I have shown you here is that all these distributed systems have inherent redundancy into them. They have 3 or 5 copies of each every data item on 3 or 5 servers. However, despite this redundancy, even a single fault introduced into a single node can cause global harmful effects such as data loss or corruption. Further, we notice that these are not just due to some implementation bugs in all of these systems. These are some fundamental root problems in all of these systems that are prevalent across all these systems, which I will talk about in the next slide. As I told you, there are 4 fundamental root causes. However, for the purpose of this talk, I'm just going to concentrate on just 2, which I believe are the most interesting ones. So the first observation that we make is corruption and crash handling are entangled. What do I mean by this? I'll illustrate this with an example. Let's consider Kafka. It's a message-based queuing system. All the incoming messages are stored in a log. Each message has 2 parts. It has a data part, and each message is also checksummed. So similar messages are appended to the log. Now let's say a Kafka node tries to append a second message into the log. Unfortunately, a system crash happens while it is doing that, and so the entry is only partially appended. Now the node recovers, it comes back, it scans the log, it finds out there is some problem in the second entry because it will notice that there is a checksum mismatch. Now, the action that the Kafka node takes at this point is to truncate the log at the last proper message. So the last proper message here is message 1, so it just truncates up to that point. And notice that this is okay because we have just lost the uncommitted data. We were just in the process of appending it. We did not finish appending that. So it's okay to lose that data. Consider a very similar scenario, but slightly different one. We have safely persisted all the 3 messages. We have acknowledged the clients. Now, one of the data blocks holding message 1 actually gets corrupted because of a faulty device. Now, the Kafka node just scans the log. It finds out there is some problem in the log. Again, the action it takes is to truncate the log at 0, which is the last proper message. And so, but here notice that these 2 items have been committed, but the node took the same action as it took for the crash case, and so it has actually lost the committed data. So we talked about this problem to many developers, and many developers agree that this kind of entanglement is a problem. That is, given these 2 cases, they cannot differentiate which is which. They cannot say whether it was actually due to a system crash or whether it was actually due to a faulty device. They cannot reason about the state. So we believe to actually recover from these kind of cases, we need to discern these 2 cases. Whenever you see a checksum mismatch, you need to be able to pinpoint and say, hey, this was because of a system crash or this was because of a faulty device. So the next observation that we'll make is there is some sort of unsafe interaction between the local protocols and the global protocols. This is sort of an extension from the previous example. Let's take the same example. So some intermediate message was corrupted. So the node found that there was a checksum mismatch, and the action it took was to truncate the log up to the last proper message. And so it lost the committed data. However, notice that this was just the local behavior of the node. If you have 5 servers in the system, just one node does this. So it's not possible for the entire system to lose the data, you would think, right? So this is just the local behavior. Now, what can happen is Kafka maintains something called the in-sync replicas. So what that set essentially means is that all the nodes in that set contain all the committed data in the system and so are capable of becoming the leaders. However, when the node performs this kind of truncation, it's not removed from the in-sync replicas, and so the node which actually deleted the data can actually become the leader. Now, notice that the followers still have the copies of the messages. There could be 4 followers here, and just the leader has just lost the copy. Now, however, when the client reads, it just goes to the leader. The leader thinks it's the authoritative copy in the system, and so it just returns message 0, which leads to a silent data loss because it has eaten up messages 1 and 2. Finally, what happens next is the leader says, hey, I am the authoritative copy. Here is what your log should look like. So it asks the followers to truncate up to message 0. And the followers are not expecting this. They're saying that the leader can be either equivalent to me or ahead of me, not behind me. So the followers are just hitting assertion and then they're failing. Now, any subsequent write which requests 2 nodes, the leader and a follower, will fail because all the nodes have crashed, only the leader is available, so you cannot satisfy those writes. And so the system becomes write unavailable. So as you can note here that a node took some wrong action locally, and that affects how the global protocol behaves. Specifically, the node just wrongly truncated the committed data, and that leads to data loss and unavailability in Kafka. So we believe to recover from these kind of scenarios, when you're designing a solution which can actually recover from storage faults, you need to carefully think about how these two pieces are going to interact. So to summarize the first part, we analyzed how distributed storage systems react to storage faults. We studied 8 systems. We showed that redundancy does not imply fault tolerance. Even a single fault can cause catastrophic problems. And all of these problems are due to some fundamental root causes across these systems. Specifically, faults are often undetected. Crashing is the most common reaction. Crash and corruption handling are entangled. And finally, there is some sort of unsafe interaction that's possible between the local layer and the global distributed protocols. So that was part 1. Now we are going to build solutions to address these problems. Right. So let's talk about how to recover a piece of data that's corrupted in a distributed system. Right. Let's say we have 5 copies here, and one of the copies is corrupted. We want to recover this piece of data. Let's start with a very simple and widely used approach, which I think probably many people have tried, is to delete the data on that node, just restart that node. It's very popular because if you go to Stack Overflow and say, hey, ZooKeeper fails to start, what do I do with this node? And the first response that you get is, try clearing all the state by deleting the node's data and then just restart the node. Even the developers of ZooKeeper prescribe something similar. They say on a file corruption, go ahead and delete all the files, restart the server. So this approach looks reasonable, right? We have many copies of the same data replicated on the several servers. So if you just delete one copy, it should be fine. The system is going to automatically fix that node from the redundant copies. So let's go ahead and apply this approach. So I'm going to delete this corrupted copy and then restart the server. In this case, actually the system fixes the corrupted node. It goes to a different node, it fetches the data, and then fixes the corrupted node. So this approach seems intuitive and it works, right? So it's all good. Unfortunately, it's not so easy. If you think more carefully about this, this approach can lead to a global data loss. This is surprising because you still have redundant copies, you just deleted one copy, then how could you end up in a global data loss? Consider this scenario, where the item was replicated to a bare majority of servers in the first place, 3 out of 5 servers. Now one copy got corrupted, and according to this prescribed approach, we are going to delete this copy and restart the server. Now, at this point, it's possible that the functional nodes could operate slowly or they could even just crash. And it's also possible for the recently recovered node to form a majority with the other nodes which have not seen the data. And we so now have a majority of nodes in the system which do not have any idea about the committed data in the system, which means that the system has silently lost the data that it promised as committed to the clients. So the problem underlying this approach is that the recovery approach is oblivious to how the underlying protocols are operating in the distributed system. Specifically, the delete and rebuild approach that I showed you is oblivious to the update protocol used by the underlying distributed system. So our proposal, therefore, is to design a recovery approach carefully based on the properties of the underlying protocols of the distributed system. For example, when you're designing a solution, you need to think more carefully about is there a dedicated leader in the system, or what are the constraints on which nodes can become the leader, and so on. We call such an approach protocol-aware approach. So in this work, we have applied part to replicated state machines. We focus on RSMs because for a number of reasons. First, RSMs are the most fundamental piece in building reliable distributed infrastructure. And because of the high fault tolerance properties that they provide, many systems depend on RSM systems. For example, if you take GFS, Colossus, or Bigtable, it depends on Chubby. If you take HBase or Kafka, it depends on ZooKeeper, and so on. So if you just protect the RSM systems from storage faults, it will automatically improve the reliability of many systems that are dependent on these kind of systems. However, applying PAR to replicated state machines is inherently a hard problem because RSMs provide strong data consistency and durability guarantees, and even a small misstep can break these guarantees. So before we go into how the solution actually works, I just want to set some context of we all understand what RSM is. So RSM is just a very simple paradigm to make any program more reliable. The key idea is to run the same program on many servers, and if they all start from the same initial state, and if they all apply the same sequence of inputs, they will all essentially produce the same outputs. So that's how you make a program reliable, just by running many copies of the same program on many machines. A key property of RSM systems is that the system should be able to make progress and give correct results as long as a majority of servers are up and able to talk to each other. Typically, a consensus protocol such as Paxos or Raft sits in front of these state machines, and it ensures that all these state machines process the input commands in the same order. So with that, now let's take a deeper look at how replicated state is updated in a replicated state machine system. So first, the commands from the clients are stored in something called the log. This is on the disk. And now let's say there is a node called the leader to which the clients talk to, and there are also a bunch of followers. Now let's say the client wants to execute a new command on the state machine. It sends this command to the leader. The leader, on receiving this command, persists this command to its on-disk log, and then also it also replicates the command to the followers. The followers also do the same thing by carefully writing that command to their disk and then responding back. Once the leader knows that a majority of servers have successfully appended this command to their on-disk logs, it can take this command, apply it to the state machine, and return the result to the client. At this point, the command is considered to be committed, and the safety condition that the system needs to satisfy is that committed commands must not be lost or overwritten in any sort of failures. Periodically, the in-memory state machine is snapshotted down to disk, and the logs are garbage collected because we cannot have infinitely growing logs because that will go and exhaust the disk space. So since we are interested in protecting against storage faults, we need to carefully understand what are the different persistence structures RSM systems use. As I told you, there is a log, there is a snapshot, and additionally, there is some crucial metadata information. One interesting bit about this meta info is that it cannot be recovered from redundant nodes because this information is very specific to each node in the system, whereas the log and the snapshots, you can recover it from other nodes because that's the shared state. All these structures could be affected by a disk corruption or a latent sector error, and so on a read, depending upon the file system, you can either get a corrupted data access or you can get a read error, and so on. So at a high level, control has two components. First is the storage layer, which manages every node's local data, and it reliably detects faults. And then we have the distributed recovery layer, which recovers the faulty data from the redundant copies and other servers over the wire. Both these layers carefully exploit RSM-specific knowledge that is protocol-aware to correctly and quickly recover faulty data. Control guarantees that committed data will never be lost. As long as you have one copy in the system, system will find that and recover that copy. And in some rare cases where all copies are faulty, which is highly unlikely, the system will correctly remain unavailable. It will not silently eat up your data. And it also provides the highest possible availability. So let's talk about how control local storage works first. As I told you, the main function of the storage engine is to detect and identify faults. And we would like to perform these functions with low performance overheads and space overheads. I'm not going to go into the details of how this storage layer actually works. However, I'm going to discuss this interesting problem of how we can solve the problem of crash and corruption entanglement that I showed previously. Just to recap, there were two scenarios. One, during the system crash, you end up in a checksum mismatch. In this case, you can just truncate it because it is unacknowledged. And the other case was that an intermediate entry in the disk gets corrupted. In this case, you cannot truncate because you could possibly lose committed data. So you need to solve this problem. You need to be able to say which is which, so that in the first case, you can just truncate and continue. In the second case, you need to be carefully recover the from different copy on another machine. However, current systems conflict these two conditions, as I told you earlier. Even ZooKeeper has this problem. So now let's see how we can solve this problem. So for every entry that we write into the log, we can write a small commit record saying that I have written this entry. And there are many such entries and commit records. Now let's say we end up in a case where the commit record is not present on the disk, but we see there is a checksum mismatch for an entry. Then we can be sure that we did not write that entry completely, because if we had written that, we would have the commit record for that entry. So if this is the case, we can be sure that the system crashed in the middle of the update. It's not due to a disk corruption. So in this case, we can just locally discard that entry because you don't need to recover it. And so you can just discard it and then skip recovery. However, consider this case when the commit record is present and the checksum mismatch happens for that entry. In this case, it's possible that entry is just corrupted and you need to recover that entry from the redundant copies. However, think about this case where you have, for the last entry in the log, you have the commit record present and there is a checksum mismatch. Can you say whether it is a system crash or a corruption? Actually, you cannot. For example, it could possibly be a corruption. It could have been that all the entries were safely written and then one copy got the last entry got corrupted later. Or it's also possible that you just you were trying to write the last entry into the system, and just before you issued the fsync to the log, and if the entry had spanned two blocks, it's possible that the commit record reached the disk first, because if you don't issue fsyncs at the right places, the file systems can reorder the writes to the disk. And so it's possible that the commit record can hit the disk first, and also a portion of the entry could hit the disk, and the crash can happen. And when the system recovers, it's going to see this state. Actually, there is no difference between these two states. So you cannot differentiate which is which here, right? But this is just a problem with for the last entry. However, we find that this is not specific to control. It's actually a fundamental limitation in any log-based system. And we have a proof that you cannot actually solve this problem without putting additional fsyncs in the protocol. So in control, if you cannot just disentangle, if you end up in this kind of state, we safely say that, oh, this could probably be a corruption. We just better be careful and just ask the redundant nodes and see if we can recover the data from the other nodes. So that's about the storage layer. Now let's talk about the distributed recovery layer. So as I told you, there is this distributed log recovery. The log has to be recovered, and also the snapshots. However, for the purpose of this talk, I'm just going to concentrate on the log recovery. So before we go into how log recovery works, I'll just briefly point out some of the interesting attributes of RSM protocols. As I told you, it's leader-based. All the updates flow through the leader. And a leader could exist only for a period of time. And if the leader changes, the time changes. That is, the time is divided into something called epochs. And for every epoch, you get a new leader. And so each log entry in the system is uniquely identified by the index in the log, and also the epoch in which it was appended into the log. And most systems have this leader completeness property that the leader is guaranteed to have all the committed data in the system. That is, if a node becomes the leader, you can assume that that node has all the committed data in the system. So control exploits all these properties to perform correct recovery. So now let's take a look at how log recovery actually works. As a first step, control decouples the follower recovery from the leader recovery. Fixing followers is simple because I told you that leader is guaranteed to have all the committed data in the system. So for example, let's say, this is a hypothetical scenario, but let's consider this scenario where the followers have some faulty entries in their log, and the leader has correct copies. And given that leader is guaranteed to have all the committed data, the followers could just ask the leader, hey, saying that, hey, what is the correct value for this corrupted command that I have in my log? The leader could just supply this value to the follower. And similarly, all the other followers can ask, and then the leader can easily fix those followers. So the interesting part in the log recovery is the leader log recovery. Fixing followers is simple, as I told you. So let's start with a very simple case. The leader has a corrupted entry here. And notice that there are two correct copies on different servers. And so the leader can ask for this entry to the different servers. And in this case, either of these nodes can provide the correct copy. And once we have fixed the leader, fixing the other nodes is trivial, as I told earlier. However, sometimes fixing the leader's log can be tricky. For example, consider this case. The leader has a corrupted entry, but no other node in the system has any idea about this entry. Or some node knows about this entry, but it is currently down. It has crashed after seeing this entry. However, we need to correctly fix the leader. If we don't fix the leader, the system may stall because the updates have to flow through the leader. To recover from this kind of scenarios, the main insight that we get is, while it is required to recover committed data, it's okay to lose uncommitted data. So, and also discarding the uncommitted entries as early as possible is very important, because if you do that, the leader can go ahead and make progress. So the leader, to fix its log, it queries the faulty entry to all the other servers. And if a majority of the servers say that they do not have this entry, then the leader can confirm that that entry must be uncommitted. Because for an entry to be committed, at least a majority of servers should have persisted that entry. And so in this case, the leader can discard the faulty entry and just continue. On the other hand, if that entry were committed, at least one node in any majority would have the correct value for that command. And so the leader can fix its log using one such response. Sometimes the leader could either discard or fix depending upon the situation. For example, take this case. The leader asks for the correct entry. The second node could give the correct value, or it's also possible that the three other nodes could come and say that they do not have that entry, which is a majority of responses. So depending upon the order in which the responses arrive at the leader either discards or fixes the log. Specifically, if one occurs before two, that is the correct node responds with the correct value, then the leader can fix its log. If two happens before one, the leader will discard the log. But notice that either of these things are fine, right? If we take the first path, if we have fixed something that's uncommitted, that's fine. If we take the second path, we have just truncated something that's uncommitted. That's also fine because we have not given a commitment to the client yet for that command. So there are several other interesting corner cases that I'm not going to talk about in this talk. There is more in the paper. I'll share the links. You can read them there. I'll show you some evaluation results. So this is one example of a reliability experiment that we conduct. Let's say we have the log here. We randomly choose some file system blocks which are backing up the log, and then just introduce a corruption using the tool that I showed you in the first part of the talk. And because of this, many entries could be corrupted and so on. The original systems, that is the systems without the control modification, are when we inject corruptions, they are unsafe in 30% of the cases. That is, they can eat up your data silently, or they become unavailable. When you inject errors, the original systems are unavailable in half of the cases. Control, on the other hand, always recovers from these kind of cases, and it promises that committed data will never be lost, which is, it's safe, and it's also available in all the cases. We conduct very similar experiments, such as targeted entry corruptions, crashes and lagging nodes, on top of which we introduce corruptions, we introduce snapshot corruptions, we introduce file system metadata faults, such as corrupted inodes, improper inodes, and so on, into many nodes. And the summary is that original systems were unsafe or unavailable in many cases, whereas the control systems were actually safe and available in all the cases. In some rare cases, which we exercised to test the thoroughness of control, control correctly remained unavailable in some cases where all copies were faulty, which is sort of rare, but we just show that that's the property that control gives. So we get all these reliability improvements with some overheads in the performance. So here is a workload. We are going to insert 1K entries repeatedly into ZooKeeper, and we're going to measure the performance for both the original system and the control version. As you can see, the overheads are not big. Control introduces an overhead of 4%. And notice that it does so because we are writing this additional commit record for every entry that we are going to append. That's why we are getting this 4% overhead. And we do not write it in place. We just seek and write. That's why you lose some spatial locality properties. However, this is the kind of the worst case workloads because our workloads are just writes. So for every request, you are going to seek and write, and so on. But for workloads which have a mix of both kind of reads and writes, it's not going to be so much. It's going to be lesser than 4%. So to summarize the second part, recovering from storage faults is tricky. Most approaches are protocol oblivious, and so they cause data loss or unavailability. To correctly recover, an approach needs to be protocol aware. And control is one such approach which we have applied to RSM-based systems. Control ensures safety and provides high availability with little performance overheads. To summarize this entire talk, in the first part, I showed you how we understand and measure and understand how distributed storage systems react to storage faults. Our main result was that redundancy does not imply fault tolerance, and these are due to some fundamental root causes. To fix these problems, in the second part of the talk, we build solutions. And control is one such solution which provides safety and availability with little overheads. So to conclude, even the obvious things that we expect from distributed systems, that redundant copies will help recover bad data, or even more generally, that redundancy implies reliability, are surprisingly hard to achieve. We believe protocol awareness is the key to correctly designed recovery mechanisms in a distributed system. That is, the mechanism needs to understand what's going on underneath in the system. However, this is just a first step. We have just applied part to RSM. Other class of systems still remain vulnerable. So I'll just finish with this last slide. The tool that I talked about is currently available online. Many people are using something very similar now. CockroachDB adapts something very similar. Even Jepsen now runs a variation of this kind of tool. It's available here. The related papers are here. This is joint work with one of my co-students, Aishwarya, and our advisors, Andrea and Ramsey. We have also a couple of other collaborators from UT Austin and another professor from Wisconsin. With that, thank you. Thank you for coming.